tomorrow because a lot of this stems from allegedly an IV he took after the wedding for dehydration. Are you going to be making sure that something like that doesn't happen again?
That's out of my control. Mm-hmm. You know, unless I called in my homies and we all got AK-47 and say, look, man, we're going to your house and we're going to stick with you until you walk into that ring. Mm-hmm. You know, it's out of my control. So that's something they have to deal with.
Mm-hmm. So what's next for Amir Khan?
What did you say?
What's next for Amir Khan?
Yeah, exactly.
I don't know. I talked to him about 3 weeks ago, but he was in Malaysia, I think. So he usually fights in December. I haven't heard any names or, you know, what's
he doing in Malaysia then, on holiday with his wife? Is he?
I have no idea, Gary.
You mean you're not in contact with him 4 times a day?
No.
What do you make it?
Do you think that he needs to stop? Like you say, he's away a lot. He goes to every opening. You know, he's in the public eye a lot. Do you think he needs to cut some of that out and concentrate for
a period of time? From a coach's perspective, of course. You know, I mean, if you're serious about your craft, if you're serious about being, you know, leaving your mark in the sport and being great, there are plenty of examples ahead of you that lets you know that you have to focus on your craft. If that's your focus, then it's just a matter of time before it backfires on you. There's only so much I can do for you, you see, because, you know, when a fighter has success early, when he's a millionaire, I don't know, you know, was he a millionaire before he threw his first punch?
No, he did. He signed for over $1 million with Frank Warren when he joined him.
Yeah, but he had money.
Signed big. Yeah, big. He was. Right. He's been rich since he was 17.
Yeah, well, that's what I'm saying.
It's a different kind of hunger he's got, isn't it?
Yeah. So there's right there. That's could be a curse if the people that you depend on the most and the people that who are in your lives that have influence over your life, if they have to be able to keep you grounded, you see. And if they can't keep you grounded, then, you know, these types of things, you know, can come up. You know, I often told him he should be undefeated, you know, but it's up to him.
You mentioned a little while ago that you wanted him to be with you through the year longer than he had been initially. Have you got him for 6 months of the year at the moment?
Well, you know, when he had the time off that time, when he took a year off, we were able to put quite a bit of time together. And I think that's why you started seeing the changes, some of the changes in him, you know. And also at that time, you know, coming off the Garcia fight, I would think that he was more driven, more focused on you. But you know, after you put 5 wins in a row together, and, you know, your name is once again being mentioned, you know, in big fights and stuff, sometimes you can have a mental letdown.
But you're only together 4 months of the year at the moment. Two camps for 8 months,
well,
8 weeks,
no,
and then a fight.
Usually does a 10 to 12 week camp.
Right. So
you know, 6 months out of the year, that was better than what he was doing.
Yeah.
You know.
But Virgil, who would you want him to fight? I mean, Danny Garcia rematch, you have Kell Brook and England fighting Diego Chavez. Do you want the winner of that? You have, what's his name, Sean Porter. I mean, there's so many names that are attractive fights.
Well, if he wants to be great, then he needs to consider fighting all these guys. I think in Amir's case, I think when there's a little fear on the table and danger exists, I think I got a better fighter. I think he focuses more because he knows that one more knockout, that's it.
A lot of people want to see him and Pacquiao fight. I've heard it at a lot of different gyms and trainers. Would you like that if it happened?
I mean, I don't pick his fights. I go along with him. My personal opinion is he don't need Manny Pacquiao. What does he need Manny Pacquiao for?
Would you like to see him fight then? Does Kell Brook appeal to you as a fight? It would be massive for him in the UK.
I would hope at some point that they both fight each other. Yeah. I mean, I know it's good for Great Britain.
Yeah.
It would be good for him. And good for boxing, you know. So yeah, I think
there's a belt there as well. You know, there's a world championship belt.
Does a rematch take that fight because he seems to be against it, resisting it for quite a while now? Do you, as his coach, would you urge him to take that fight because of what's you know, up for grabs?
I've never pushed him to take the fight because it's obvious there's some things going on between him that happened long before I came on the scene. So, you know, the little bits and pieces that I get from the, well, you're disrespecting me, or you're not known, or who was winning the sparring sessions when they were amateurs, and Brooke saying what he says, and I mean, it's all the ingredients for a big fight.
Yep.
Certainly there,
correct.
You see. So at what point they make the fight, I'm sure both continue to fight, then the fight's going to happen.
Yeah, but how can he not be ready for it? That's the point. I mean, how, it's a mystery to us. I know you're not his advisor, you're his trainer, so you're not making those decisions for him. Obviously, you are his trainer, you're the man shaping the second period of his career, you know, in terms of his skill set. But it's a mystery that he won't take this big fight when he's clearly not going to get a Mayweather fight, you know?
Yeah, I mean, I don't blame you for looking at it like that, you know, but it doesn't frustrate me.
I know
because, you know, look, I got a young heavyweight man that 6'3 and a half, 228 amateur that looks like a light heavyweight. And I sent him up to the U.S. Championships, and he walked right through the whole tournament. So, you know, my focus is on who's there. You know, I have a Russian kid, he's down here training now, but his television debut will be October, I want to say 13th or 14th. My focus is who's in the gym. Now, of course, if I had complete say-so and control over, number one, I know he respects me. Number two, the dynamics of Amir and what they do is out of my hand and over my head, okay? If I had to assess it as a coach, I think he's letting his career, let me put it this way. I think that if he was, you know, here, like he's supposed to be, even if he doesn't live here, but would come and spend time, you know, in between fights, like, you know, he travels and everything else, that he would be twice as good now as he was then. And that's what, you know, I visualized for him. That's why I agreed to train him, because that's how he was talking. You see, he wanted to be the best, and he said he was willing to make the sacrifice. He asked me, did I have time for him? Because I'm the reward, and I says, you know, I don't have a number one. Whoever has the fight, that's who's the priority. So, but, you know, over a period of time, it's a lot going on. And, you know, my job is to be honest with him, which I am. You know, very honest with him. I'm not, I don't need to eat on a fighter, you know. And simply put, it's like I told him, when you have the talent that you have, I'm not going to bite my tongue, or I'm not going to make any concessions when you have this kind of talent. You know, you should be striving to be the best that ever did it. And if that's too much for you, go get another coach. You see? So, but
do you straight talk to him in that way? And what's his reaction?
Ask him.
Does he just sit there as if you're the headmaster lecturing him?
Ask him. He'll tell you.
Sorry?
Ask him. He'll tell you. Yeah. I mean, but how can anybody be negative against someone who says, you know, I'm not going to overlook any, you know, half-assed effort. I'm not going to overlook this, you know. I'm not going to overlook that. You see? How can anybody be upset with that? Because first they have to be true to themselves.